The recording. Okay, so welcome everybody to the lecture 2 on what is GEMS and the first tutorials on C3A. So I hope everyone has good sound quality and hears me clearly. So we would like to discuss a bit the first tutorials. And I will also maybe from time to time ask questions at certain steps and ask if you have problems with this. And of course, you can also always interrupt me and ask questions, and then we will try to solve it. And what we cannot solve during our time here at the tutorial, we could also solve bilateral after the lecture. So feel always free if you have problems with tutorials or also with the next tutorials to send me an email with a question, or then we could also do even the bilateral Zoom to solve some problems. I should be also more or less available also on the afternoons, as I might have some appointments and maybe not answer directly, but I should be more or less around. Of course, keep in mind that we have time difference of some hours, so if you contact me during your late afternoon, I will be in bed sleeping. Okay, so we now go to the next slide. So this first tutorial, this first presentation is a short overview on the thermodynamic modeling. There will be a quick glimpse at chemical equilibrium, modeling software, databases, and then there is some general information, what is GEMS, installation of GEMS, we can skip this. And then the main goal is to go through the first tutorial. Maybe I could ask first, did everybody somehow could manage to finish the tutorials, or were there some problems?
Yeah, I think the basic simulation, I can manage it, but I always meet some problems.
Okay, then we will go through it and then we will try to solve it. So I will also do it live on the GEMS and then we can do it. And if you really have a problem, then you could also share your screen and then we can do it together, either within the lecture or we can do it bilaterally afterwards.
Okay.
So thermodynamic modeling, just to explain quickly, what is it? So it's somehow simple example is this chemical equilibrium, gypsum in a glass of water. So if we put the gypsum inside, the gypsum will dissolve. You will have calcium ions, you will have sulfate ions now dissolved in water. And of course, the reaction equation we can write like this, that the gypsum is in equilibrium, the solid gypsum is calcium ions, sulfate and water. And of course, from this, you can calculate the solubility of gypsum, which solubility product of gypsum, which you can look up in some specific databases or tables or books. Actually, it's the solubility product is not the product of the concentrations. This would be only true at a very, very dilute situation. If we have concentrated solutions, then the ions, they see each other, they feel each other. And then there's a correction coefficient, the so-called activity coefficient, which we multiply with the concentration, and then we end up with the calcium activity instead of the concentration. And to calculate the activity coefficient, we will come back later to this, you will have a couple of different models which are normally specific for certain ionic strengths in the solution. And the one we are using here is the so-called extended Debye-Hückel. You find it also in a lot of textbooks. Actually, if you go here, it's not, strictly speaking, not so easy, because we might have also other species in the solution. So we have also the OH-, the H+, we might have the ion pair, the calcium sulfate zero, which you see here. Or you can have also, for example, the CaOH+. So there are also other complexes, other equilibria in the solution, which we also need to consider. And this is also, this speciation is also considered in the GEMS database. So the concentration of calcium and sulfate, okay, this is example if we add the potassium hydroxide, and this can be modeled. We will do a similar exercise later. I will maybe quickly go through it. So depending, so the total concentration of the calcium is this 17 millimole, but the calcium is not only the calcium 2 plus, but it's also this calcium OH plus and this ion pair, this calcium sulfate. And for example, if we add hydroxide, then our calcium concentration decreases because we need to maintain also the activity product of portlandite. And if we precipitate portlandite, then our calcium concentration goes down. And in return, as we need to maintain the solubility or activity product of the calcium sulfate, our sulfate concentrations need to increase. Okay, so maybe we quickly go through it. So you see, it's not so easy, especially if you have different speciations, and this is why it's very complicated to calculate it by hand. And for this, you need a software like GEMS, and you need this geochemical software. And together with this geochemical software, you need a geochemical database. You need, of course, an interface to type in your problem. You saw this already yesterday. And then the geochemical software will solve our problem by calculations. And there are various geochemical codes around. And what we are using is the GEMS, which is developed at Paul Scherrer Institute, which is also a federal research institute in Switzerland, one of our sister institutes. But there are also other softwares, which you see here on the webpage, on the slide. Some are freeware, but there are also other codes which are commercial products. Strictly speaking, you get comparable results regardless of which software you're using, but there are differences, of course, in the database. It all stands and falls with the quality of the data. Thermodynamic database, I will skip this more or less. It's, you see a bit what is inside. You have all these aqueous phases, aqueous speciations, gaseous speciations, solid phases, which are in this PSI-NAGRA thermodynamic database. And then we have the cement-specific SEM database, where we have a lot of phases which are specific for cementitious systems. And all this data are based on solubility measurements at different temperatures and solid phase characterization. We will have a special lecture on this. Okay, so we need geochemical program, thermodynamic data, and then we need somehow a problem. We need to define what is our input, and then our software calculates what is the stable phase assemblage. At these slides, we will skip. We already looked at it, and we will go it. This is also a slide added by Barbara. What is GEMS? Actually, GEMS in German, it's we say Gemse for such an animal which lives in the Alps. The English speaker, they say gem to mean a gemstone, or it could be some sweets. But our GEMS for geochemist means the Gibbs Energy Minimization Software for thermodynamic modeling. This we skip, you already installed. Maybe I will now go to one of the next slides. Maybe just to mention, we have a homepage at EMPA where we will also put all the course material, all the databases which can be found here at this webpage. So also check there regularly for updates or for new course material, new online material. It will be updated on a whatever annual or biannual basis. Okay, we already looked at this a bit. Now we start again with the tutorial. I will now also need to start GEMS. Okay, do you see the screen of GEMS or do you see the screen of the PowerPoint? Could someone give me feedback? Do you see now GEMS?
No.
Okay.
Just see the PowerPoint.
Okay. I will now do the GEMS. Okay,
it's okay. You can see the GEMS.
Okay, good. I now need to go here to the second screen. Wait a bit, and now we will do the tutorial. Okay. Or is anybody of you interested to do the tutorial by him or herself and share the screen? Or should I do it? It's up to you. Okay, then I will do it. Okay, to remember what we wanted to do is that we calculate the C3A hydration. And I now go to here. Okay, now you should see the PowerPoint again, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so actually the first we did yesterday, and I could do it if you wish. So we make a new project, and now I need to invent different name. And this is so actually the names are unique, you cannot reuse it. And then it's very, and you only have very limited amount of characters, so it's very important that you also make a comment.
Sorry, we can't see the GEMS.
Sorry. I now need to go to GEMS. Yes. Okay, now you should see it.
Okay.
So actually, you need to give a short name. And you only have limited amount of characters, huh? So it's gone here. Huh? Then it's very important that you give a comment. And as Barbara said, don't use spaces or funny characters here. And if we now go to also this one important thing you need to know, if you go here to GEMS, I will now change here. I will now go here. Now you should see my Explorer. Do you see it?
Yes.
If you go here to GEMS Library, GEMS 3 Projects, here you have all your projects. Yeah. Okay. And to back up, you can zip the whole folder and then store it somewhere. From time to time, it's important to back up your projects, to keep them, especially the good and running projects. What you should never do is to rename this folder, because then it cannot read. Because if you open now one of those, you see that this C3A, this is our name. Now the folder is the name of the project, but this is also inside here. And if you change this, then it will not recognize. If you rename the folder, it will not recognize the project again. No? Okay, I now go back, oops. I made a mistake. Now we go back to GEMS. Okay. So we now make a new project. And here you have these different selections. Normally you don't need the non-ideal fluids, you don't need the dispersed solids, and you don't need the liquids and glasses. Okay. Then you should always use the PSI NACRA database, because this contains all these equilibria, especially of the aqueous phase, all this calcium 2 plus, calcium OH plus, and so on. This is all built in. And then here is another database. That's the subscript database. Here you find also a couple of inorganic and organic phases, which might be of interest for other projects. But in this course, we will not use it, but you might find some useful phases. And then we have here the third party. By default, we have the ClaySort database and the SEM database. And we will use the SEM database. And the SEM database has a couple of options. And as we saw yesterday already, if we don't want to model alkali activated materials, we should deselect this. This AEM is specific for alkali activated slag. So we deselect. Then also here we have four different CSH models. Strictly speaking, GEMS would work if we would use all the models, but it's not recommended to have different models for CSH. So we will use only CSHQ in this whole tutorial. So this is the standard setup recommended for using cements. Now we go to next. And now we need to think about first, which elements do we want to use in our modeling? We want to want to work with C3A. So we need the calcium, the aluminum, and then we want to calculate what happens if we add calcium sulfate and what happens if we add calcium carbonate. And then as we saw yesterday, there are two different types of nitrogen. This is nitrogen which is treated as inert in air. And if you want to have reactive nitrogen, like if you want to work with nitrates and so on, then you need to activate this N. So normally this is deactivated. We could use this to simulate a synthetic air, but we could also use the oxygen to create kind of an atmosphere and to create an oxidizing environment. And this is always recommended because otherwise we might go to reducing conditions and then some funny faces or some funny features may appear. Okay, now we go next. And now we come to all these things we discussed yesterday on the different models for the, for the activity coefficients. If I now go back to this one, I need to change again here. Okay, now you should see the PowerPoint again.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, that's very good. So again, to repeat, this is air, synthetic air, and the nitrogen is not reactive, and this is the reactive N. And here we can use just the oxygen, and the carbon we don't need now, but it's always good if you think you could also use this element to activate it, because you cannot change easily afterwards. Okay, then you go to next, and then we come to this slide. So we have here the model of the activity coefficient with the extended Debye-Hückel equation. And then we need to select the setup. For cements, we normally use the potassium hydroxide because at late ages, the pore solution is basically potassium hydroxide. And then you need to select these parameters which fit. And then the activity of water is calculated. And if you want to know more, you can see here. And then we say, and then it's important to click check because otherwise it will not take the changes. Then you click OK. And this we already discussed yesterday. So this activity coefficient, this is because the ions feel the neighbors, other ions, the solvents, And these activity coefficients strongly depend on ionic strengths, other ionic species, and temperature. And there are these different models which are built in this GEM software. And you see, depending on the ionic strengths to be expected, you need to choose an appropriate model. And especially in our cementitious systems, we have very high ionic strengths. This is why we use this Helgeson approach. I will now switch back to the GEMS. Okay, now you should see the GEMS again.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, it's very good that you always confirm that you see the correct thing. If there's something wrong or I show the wrong screen, then I would be happy that you tell it to me. Okay, so we click here, and then you see the potassium hydroxide is the most lowest one. And here, so we need always to take here the lowest one, and then it's correct. Yeah. If you don't know, as Barbara said yesterday, if you don't know what to use, then use the sodium chloride model. Then we need to make this. We need to take here from osmotic coefficient. And then it has here still the first one. You need to make check, and then it changed. Yeah, so that's very important. Otherwise, it will not take it. This is also a general rule in GEMS. Sometimes it does not take your changes, and for this reason, you sometimes need to click into some other parts of GEMS. I will show it later to you. Now we click on OK, and then we come already to the start of this tutorial. So I need just to go further, because I have here on a second screen, I have again the presentation that I know what to do. Okay, so we name it now C3A with calcium sulfate. And we see here the first is the project name. This is already given by us when we started. This is the thermodynamic potential to minimize. Here we use the Gibbs free energy minimization, so we leave the G. Then we need to enter here a name of the chemical system. This is a running number. If you want to have several recipes of the same composition, you can give here some numbers. This means that the volume of the system is unconstrained, but I could also tell, for example, everything should be within 1 liter. Then I would need to type here a 1. And then, of course, we will have an atmosphere with a pressure, which is different from the atmospheric pressure. So we could also here use this to fix somehow or to change somehow the pressure. Then we could also give the pressure directly. We will model everything at 1 bar. And here we have the default temperature of 25 degrees. And this is an additional number. So we click now on OK. And then we end up in the recipe wizard. And there it's also very important to always add a comment what you are modeling, because you might not know it later. So I now switch back again to GEMS. Now we go here. Okay, so this is what we wanted to model. So we want to model tricalcium aluminate together with calcium sulfate, with calcium oxide and 50 grams of water. And we want to add this 0.1 gram of oxygen, which means that we have oxidizing conditions. And we have here the molar ratio sulfate to aluminate equals to 1, which means that this composition should form monosulfate. Yeah? And we will now see if this happens. Yeah? So this would be our expectation. And GEMS will now take this recipe and put it into a big bucket, cook it, and then we will have the final equilibrium. Okay, we will now go back to GEMS. Oh, sorry, I might use the wrong GEMS. Ah, there is a question in the chat. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Okay, now you should have again the GEMS.
Yes.
Okay, and now we go to the recipe wizard. Type in C3A plus calcium sulfate. And now we need to enter things. We choose here the compost. The compost provides now all the phases depending on the chemistry you choose in the periodic system. So all the compositions which are defined are now in our SEM database and in the PSI NACA database are now here. And then you can select. We will come later to all these things here. But just keep in mind, these composts are just bulk compositions, this is just bulk chemistry without any thermodynamic data adjusted, just input. No? Okay, so first we need water. And we had this 50 grams of water. Then we have 5 grams of C2A. And then feel free also to do it by yourself, if you wish. Then we have the 2.5 grams calcium oxide. And then we have the calcium sulfate, the 2.52. And then we need the oxygen 0.1. Now, if you click here, this appears automatically. But if you deselect, then it disappears again. Now, if I now click here on the oxygen, it's gone again. Okay, and then we have it already in. And then we go here to the check. And this will check if everything is fine, if there are no negative values, if everything's okay. And now we have a conflict warning. It says, oh, you have selected carbon in the periodic system, but you don't have any phase selected which contains carbon. And of course, if we have a phase included and then we have a value of zero, then this will make problems. So there are now two possible ways. We can exclude it or we can keep it. And we want to, oops, we want to keep it. No, I made probably a mistake. Okay, and I calculate it now too fast. And you see that we have this error. And this is also something very important. I now go back to the presentation. Wait. Okay, now you should see the presentation again. Okay, so this error, I think it's somewhere else in the presentation, this slide. Yes, it's here. So if you have this convergence problem, this is because you might have very low concentrations of them phases. Sometimes it's related to certain solid solutions. Then there are three parameters where you can play with. You can use this convergence tolerance parameter, use a higher value. You can use this smoothing factor with a very low number, or you could use this minimum amount of a stable phase. You can reduce it to a lower value. The most powerful one is this, and you can play a bit with this. And if nothing works, then you could try to check which phase is the origin of the problem. So you would need to, normally it's one of the solid solutions that you deactivate the solid solutions, use the pure phases instead, and then you make the calculation again and check if it works or not. And there are also here a lot of other values, and also very important, this is a general feature of GEMS, do not touch the other values. If you don't know what the purpose of a number is, and there are a lot of numbers in GEMS, do not touch it, do not change it. Okay, I now go back to GEMS and need to change my screen. Now you should see the GEMS again. Okay, so I will now go here and add this smoothing parameter. And then we go again to the single file. We check, we make the calculation. Okay, I made a mistake, so I will now create, this is the mistake already done by some of you yesterday. I will now create a new single system quickly. Sorry for that. Okay, we call it like this. Yeah, just need to go back here. Okay, the Aqua 50, the C3A 5. We need 2.5.
Yeah,
thank you. And 2.52 and 0.1. Okay. Then we check. Then we say check okay. And then we calculate. And then we have our results. Actually, it might be that the individual values here differ a bit from the values you see in the tutorial, in the slides. This depends a bit on the version of GEMS. It depends also on the mathematical processor of your computer. So basically, you should have the same values, but it could be that the last or the last two digits vary a bit. This is no reason to be worried. Okay. Now I switch back to the presentation. Okay, now we should have the presentation again. And I go back. Okay, so this we did. And then we calculated. And this is the recipe wizard, as you see. This is a detailed input recipe, which you could also use, which looks a bit differently. And then we have all our main cement hydrates, which are relevant for our system. We have included here on the input system, on the input side. And also we have the solid solutions. So a solid solution, as we discussed yesterday already, means that we have not a pure phase, but we have a phase where some of the elements are exchanged by others. An example is, for example, the calcite. Or calcite, you know, calcium carbonate can contain a bit of magnesium. So in the crystal, some of the magnesium is replaced by the calcium. Some of the calcium is replaced by the magnesium, and vice versa. Also for magnesium carbonate, some of the magnesium can be replaced by calcium. And this is the same here for the ettringite. We have here a solid solution of ettringite with 32 water and ettringite with 30 water. And in the solid solutions, you can recognize them here in this first column. If there's here a 2, then this is a solid solution, or a higher number than 2. 2 means it's a solid solution out of 2 phases. You will later see that we have also other solid solutions where we have more components. If there's a 1, then this is a pure phase. And I means here, it's an ideal solid solution, which means that there is a complete mixture between the 30 and the 32 water ettringite over the whole range of compositions. Okay, then we have here this on-off button, you saw it already. You can use this to on-off switch phases. And then you see here, for example, two solid solutions of ettringite, which contain carbonate and sulfate. And this is a non-ideal solid solution. And this non-ideal means that those solid solutions cannot be mixed over the whole range of compositions. Yeah? For example, if this magnesium, you can put a bit of magnesium in calcite, and you could put a bit calcium in magnesium carbonate. And in between, there is you cannot mix those phases. So this would be a non-ideal solid solution with a miscibility gap. On the other side, for example, you know maybe the mineral olivine. The mineral olivine is a solid solution. It's a magnesium iron silicate, and this is an ideal solid solution. So this means it's a solid solution between the magnesium silicate, which is the mineral forsterite, and the iron silicate, which is the mineral firelite. And those two, the magnesium and the iron, they can be exchanged over the whole range of compositions. No? And this would be example for an ideal solid solution. And these solid solutions, they always have a junior end member. Here, the carbonate ettringite, which is a bit of carbonate in a lot of sulfate ettringite, which is the major end member. And then we have also the other solid solution, the carbonate sulfate ettringite, where the sulfate ettringite is the junior end member, which is inside the carbonate ettringite, which is the major end member. Okay, also there are other phases contained. You see it, for example, there's ettringite with less water, meta-ettringite. There are also AFM phases, monosulfate, with less water contained in the database. You see it, for example, here, this is monosulfate with different water content. This is relevant for low water cement ratios or if you model systems without free water. Okay, so we go here. This is the other input, the detailed input. And then maybe I switch back to the GEMS. Okay. So I will go here further. Okay, so if so you go here always back to the recipe wizard. Okay, and here you could use also the detailed input with detailed input. This is basically the same, but it's more in a different way how to display it. What was also shown yesterday that you have different units. The unit G means gram, but there are also various other units which you can look up in GEMS. If you go here to press F1, then you can see a table. If you go here to quality concentration codes, here you see in the help function the different codes. But you will mainly use whatever the M, or you will use the G. There are not so many which you really need. Okay.
Evan, can we change the recipe here?
Yes, you can also change it. Yes, yes, yes. You can. It's a different way to do it. Older versions of GEMS only had this. Newer versions had then this recipe wizard. So you could add now. You could now change it. You could now enter 60. You check. Just always do check, okay. And then you can calculate, and then you see different result. Okay. So that's also possible. Mm-hmm. Okay. So then we maybe go quickly through those. If you go here, you see now the results. You see that we have this amount of gaseous phase, amount of aqueous phase, amount of solid, pH. This is the PE value. It's positive. It means oxidizing conditions. And this is ionic strength. And also, as I said, these numbers may be slightly different from what you see in the tutorial. And as you see here, we now added sufficient water. GEMS sometimes makes problems if you don't add sufficient water. No? Because it runs out of water and then it will use phases with less water, and if and sometimes it also may crash. You could try maybe if you wish what happens if you don't add sufficient water that everything hydrates. Okay. Good. So if we now go here, you see a lot of different settings. You see, I think important is, if we need to go here, here we see our results. This is the aqueous composition. So this, as we saw yesterday, this is your concentration of ions in solution. The ZZ is the charge, and the charge should be somehow zero. Then we have here the results. We have the activity, the mole fraction, activity coefficient, and then we have here the phase volume and the phase mass. In this is in cubic centimeter, phase mass in gram. And then we have here the activity coefficients and a lot of other information. What I think for you the most important is the aqueous composition and the phase composition. Okay, I switch back to the presentation. Okay. Okay, so we calculated everything. Also, if you check, you see that this is your chemical input, that the molar ratio aluminum oxide sulfate is 1, as we wished, and we did the calculation. I'll just go quickly through it. Then we have the results. And you see that always here on the left side, you have this calculated single systems, you have your different calculations. So within one project, you can have different amount of single phases, single calculations. This would be the name of the single system. And if you now check the results, we have 2.5 mole of aqueous phase, which is not only the water, but also the dissolved ions. And then we have 0.0032 mole gaseous phase, which is our oxygen. Of course, a small part of the oxygen will be dissolved in water, and also some part of our water will evaporize and will be in the gaseous phase. Then we have as solid products, we have traces of ettringite, and we have monosulfate, and very down below we have the portlandite. And our monosulfate is a solid solution between the monosulfate with sulfate and the monosulfate with only hydroxide, which is the C4AH13. And as we have this solid solution, we have some sulfate available to make ettringite. Actually, if you remember, we calculated the system in a way that we have only monosulfate, but due to the fact that we have a solid solution where a bit of the sulfate is exchanged by hydroxide, we see also a bit of ettringite. That's the reason for this. And this we discussed yesterday. We have here the ideal solid solution, and here on the right you see the mole fractions, which is 80 mole percent of ettringite with 32 water and 20 mole percent of ettringite with 30 water. And then we have the non-ideal solution. It appears twice. It's a bit confusing, I know, but this is the way those solid solutions are set up. You somehow need to accept it as it is. And if you look here at the mole fraction, it's 10% mole percent of the hydroxy AFM in the solid solution and 90% of the monosulfate. And this is all calculated by GEMS. And generally, the solid solutions are more stable than the individual single phases. That's the reason why they are formed. Okay, and as Barbara said, very often we have also this AFT solid solution, the carbonate sulfate AFT. This is normally not really stable, can be deactivated, especially if it makes problems. But we will see this later. Okay. Yeah, this we discuss later. As we have little carbonate, we could strictly speaking, deactivate this. And to deactivate, there's also maybe something I need to show it, some pitfall you can have. I now go back to GEMS. Okay. If you are lost here in GEMS, you can always click here and then it brings you back to the single calculation. And here we have again this tab with the results, and here we have the tab with the input. And to deactivate, you could just go here and type in a minus, and then it's deactivated. Very important, if you change something here, sometimes it does not take your changes, and then you should click somewhere else inside. Huh? If you make here a plus, then click here, because otherwise it sometimes will not take your changes. I will repeat, I will show this later to you also in some other cases. It's always good to click somewhere else in GEMS that it takes all your changes. Okay. Good. Now I need to check again the presentation. Okay. I now go back to presentation again. I will change now here. Okay, you should have again the presentation. So down here you see this general information, the temperature, pressure, the volume of the system. You see the pH, the PE value, it's oxidizing, and the ionic strength. The same information you got on this small a box which appears after you made the single calculation. And here you can always view the detailed results. So here you see the solid phases. This is the total amount, the volume, and the mass. And here we see that we have 1.1 gram of ettringite. We have this 10 gram, we need to add both, this 10 gram of monosulfate. And if we would scroll below, we would see that we have 3.1 gram of portlandite. You should have basically the same results. Again, as I said, it may vary slightly on the last digit or the second last, the second digit after the decimal break. It depends a bit on GEMS version on your computer, what exactly comes out. Now we look at the results at the experiments. This is some work from Thomas Matscheis, PhD thesis. We see X-ray diffraction, and we see nicely that we have residual portlandite, and we have the sulfate ettringite only in traces, as we predicted by GEMS, and the main hydrate is our monosulfate. So we see that GEMS predicts very well what we did in the experiments. And this is also something general. You should always compare your GEMS results with your experiments, because GEMS calculates the equilibrium, but maybe you have some metastabilities in your system. For example, if you have quartz present, quartz should react and form whatever phases, but it will react very slowly. And for example, in your sample, after 28 days, the quartz might not be reacted at all. So I think this is also very important that you think about a bit if you have such metastability constraints and always compare with your experiments. Because also if your experiments differ from what you model, it will tell you also something. It will not tell you that the model is wrong, but it will tell you that in your sample, the equilibrium might not be reached. So this is also a very important point, but here somehow we calculated what we predicted. This also, we looked at it already. We see here the output. And with this first part of the presentation is done. And we now continue with experimental problem part two. And part three, is someone of you willing to do it by himself to show it to the others? Otherwise, I will do it for you. No volunteers? Okay.
Sorry, I didn't bring my mouse.
Okay. No. Okay, but today I'm nice to you. There will be no volunteers, but maybe tomorrow we might.
Okay.
Maybe someone who manages to do the tutorial, the next tutorial on the cement in a good way, could think about volunteering to show it to the others.
Okay.
Okay, so just think about and then maybe someone can do it. Okay, those are the next presentations. I will now go change now to the second presentation.
I have some problems for the formal presentation.
Okay.
The first is the IR reactivity model will influence just the IR concentration or even the solid phase. We choose the other model. Yeah.
Was there a big, I think it has mainly influence, it has influence on the aqueous concentrations. But of course, as you might have different quantities of ions in solutions, you might also have different solid phases. I checked it with a couple of systems. You might have small differences, but very often the differences in the solid phases are not so big. I think in a Portland cement, for example, you will not really see it. Because maybe then you have a bit less portlandite, a bit more CSH. But of course, here in the system where you have very low quantities of ettringite, a different activity coefficient model might lead to different phase assemblage. Yeah.
Okay. And the other is, can we do simultaneously simulate different recipes? You have.
Yes, you can do it, but for this you need the process files. And this we will do on the next day, on the next tutorial. Of course, everyone starts with a single system. It's very easy. Also, I started like this when I started to begin with GEMS. But late, and you always need one single system to create a kind of a process or batch process. Of course, it's not convenient if you have a series of 20 or 50 calculations to make 50 individual calculations. Mm-hmm. And for this, we use the process files, and we will take a look at this tomorrow, or you will take a look at this tomorrow morning when you prepare, during my sleep, when you prepare the tutorials for tomorrow. Okay. But it's a good question. Of course, this is the first step to make a good single file. And then later on, one can use a single file or suitable single file to prepare then a process file. And this is a kind of a batch file. Yes, where you systematically vary, for example, temperature or composition.
And the last question is, is there any rules for choose the smoothing parameter or just choose some data that we like?
You need to try. No?
So the number is just a random number.
Yes, I would start with 0.01, and then if this will not work, it's 0.02, you should play. Of course, if you put these values too high, then also GEMS might get unstable. It's the same for this other parameter, which can be changed. Then complains that it will not reach the convergence. No? It will get some stability problems. You need to play a bit with it.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but also very good question. You need to try out. And if nothing works, then the advice is to, as this is mainly related to solid solutions. The advice is, for example, you have a solid solution for the monosulfate, that you deactivate it and activate the pure monosulfate and the pure hydroxy AFM. And then you repeat the calculation. And then if the error does not occur, then the mistake is, or the problem is due to this specific solid solution.
So
you need somehow to be like a detective to check what could be the potential error.
Okay, thank you. And
of course, keep in mind, GEMS is not like Word or like other commercial software. It's an expert system, so yeah, the things are not always as comfortable as they're used from commercial software like Word or Excel. And so there are a couple of pitfalls you just need to know. Okay. So we now go to the next examples. We still have almost 1 hour, so we have also plenty of times. Also, if one of you had a problem with one of the lectures, just let me know. If there are questions, just interrupt me. What is always a bit difficult to see for me when I'm presenting is the chat. So it's probably the best if you just speak up and interrupt me, in case there is a problem. Okay, so don't be shy.
Okay,
so this is the second part of this tutorial. So we will now do the reaction of the calcium of the C2A with other reaction partners. And again, here we have the recipe. And also I need quickly to change here on the other computer the presentation. Okay. Good. We now want to calculate the C2A plus calcium carbonate plus calcium oxide and water. And we now put a molar ratio carbonate to aluminum oxide as one. Before we had the sulfate to aluminum oxide as one. So what phase, maybe a question to you, what phase would we now expect? Any idea? Instead of the monosulfate, we now have no sulfate.
Carbonate, monosulfate.
Yeah, we will have the monocarbonate would be our expectation, yes. Okay, so I will now try to do it in the GEMS. Okay, you should see the GEMS again, correct?
Yes.
Okay, good. Now we create a new, so you could either go record create new or you could click here on this symbol. And this is now C3A CC. Everything else we leave like it is. Click on OK. And then we now come to the recipe wizard. Again, it's important to to add a comment, and then we select again the 50 grams of water. Then we have the calcium carbonate 1.86. Then we have the calcium oxide 2.86. 5. Then we have, we have the C3A, most important one. We have 5 grams. Then we have the oxygen, 0.1 grams. Then we click OK. And then we check. And now, of course, it warns we don't have sulfur. So we click now on the sulfur. We now make check OK. This is also important because that it takes it. And then we can do the calculation. We accept it. And then we see, as expected, that we have, of course, water, residual gas phase. We see that we have the monocarbonate, and we have very, very low amounts of calcite. This is, yeah, it was designed that it's only monocarbonate, but of course you have some rounding errors, and then you have residual portlandite.
Sorry.
Yes?
I have a question, sorry.
Yes, yeah, please.
I think if we forget to select the sulfate when we check, press the check button. So how can we go back to it?
Yes, it's very often there is no way back, and then it's better to start it new.
Yeah. Oh. I think we all have met this problem.
Yeah.
Can't go back.
So I also had it. I think. Then it's gone here. No, that's the problem. It's the easiest way is just to make it quickly new.
Okay.
A new project.
Okay.
You could also, for example, if you have an old one or wrong one, save.
Yeah.
You could also delete, no? If you say record, delete, or if you mark it and click here, then you could also delete it.
Okay.
But I will check. Okay. Good. So actually, basically, we got the results which we intended to have. So if we now go to the detailed results, we see that we have, we have water, we have gas, we have then this 10.5 grams of monocarbonate, we have traces of calcite, and we have the portlandite, which is expected. And so before monocarbonate, small amounts of calcite and portlandite. And now we can make just a quick check what happens if we don't add the lime. So you could also quickly check here. This is shown in tutorial. You can just change it without making a new calculation. And then we check it and calculate. And then we see some other phases. We see now instead that it forms small amounts of gibbsite, which is aluminum hydroxide. And if I now go back to the presentation, you see the presentation?
Yes.
Yes, good, very good. Okay, just go further. Okay, this we had. So we just omitted now the lime. You see it here, we just typed in a 0. And then it calculates small amounts of gibbsite. And then if we would now check the pore solution composition, we would see this data. And if we compare it with the measured pore solution, we see that the calculation calculated on the system. So someone has measured it, or maybe imagine you measured it and found this poor solution composition or the solution composition, and now compare it with your calculated poor solution composition, then you see you have much different composition. The pH is different, calcium concentration is wrong, also aluminum concentration is wrong. So there's a big difference. And the solid phase assemblage, which was determined experimentally, was the carbonate AFM, calcite, aqueous phase. There was no gibbsite detected. So in this case, the experiments do not fit to the modeling. And there's also a reason for this, because in our measurement, we did not reach the equilibrium. And for this, it's very important to compare calculations and model calculations and experiments. And the main reason for this is that aluminum hydroxide can have a variable solubility. The gibbsite is the very soluble geological sample, but very often if aluminum hydroxide forms in cementitious systems, you have it in an amorphous or microcrystalline form, and there it has a much higher solubility. So, and in our calculations, we assumed that gibbsite could be present, and then, of course, GEMS calculated with the very stable gibbsite. And then, of course, we have a different, as we have different solubility of the gibbsite compared to the amorphous aluminum hydroxide, we also get a different solution composition. And this might even lead to wrong solid phase assemblages. And in the database, we have three different aluminum hydroxides, which is an amorphous one, a microcrystalline one, and the gibbsite. And you see that the amorphous one is a bit 1.5 decades higher solubility product. So which means it's a bit more soluble. And then one can try out to use this, as we assume if our C3A hydrates we form as hydration times are maybe quite short, we assume that the aluminum hydroxide forms in an amorphous form. And for this reason, we can suppress the formation of gibbsite and microcrystalline aluminum hydroxide, assume that we might form the amorphous one, and repeat the calculations. I will now go again to the GEMS. You should now see GEMS.
Yes.
Good. Okay. Okay, there are two ways to do it. You see here the gibbs on the input side, you see here the gibbsite, the microcrystalline, and the amorphous aluminum hydroxide. And the easiest way is just to put here a minus and here a minus, which means that this phase is not considered at all in calculations. There is another way to do it. Now we go back. There's another way to do it. If you click here and open it, you see here the lower KC and the upper KC. And this means the minimum amount of a phase which can be present in our calculations. And this is the maximum amount of a phase which can be present. And if we just type in a zero, then it calculates also with the microcrystalline aluminum hydroxide. It's still in the calculations, but the maximum amount which is allowed to be precipitated is zero. So this is the other way to exclude it. Okay? You got it?
Yes.
Okay. And this we will also, there's also a later tutorial where we calculate saturation indices, where we need to do it like this, where we need to need to consider it. So normally, if you just make quick calculations, it's probably easier to type in a minus if you deactivate it because you see it directly. Okay, we will now calculate. Okay, the amorphous one we have. This one is deactivated, and the Gibbs side we also deactivated. We now try both ways. The interesting thing is also, if you do like this here for the microcrystalline one, you see it also in the recipe wizard. In the recipe wizard, you now see this DUL, aluminum hydroxide microcrystalline quantity 0 mole, which means that the upper limit of concentration of aluminum hydroxide is now set to 0. So you could, strictly speaking, also do it in the recipe wizard. You could also go here, take one, you could take, for example, ettringite and put it to 0. Okay, I will now delete this. And the other one we keep. Now we can make our calculations, check. Okay. And now, we see that we don't form any of the aluminum hydroxide, but we form now somewhat more calcite. Mm-hmm. And if you now switch back to the presentation, you should now see the presentation. Here you see again this slide where we have these two options to do it, with the plus and the minus, and this upper limit. So there are two ways to do it. But personally, for calculations of solid phases, it's easier to make it here with the plus and minus, and you see it directly. Okay, so what we now did is to suppress the formation of gibbsite and microcrystalline aluminum hydroxide, and we repeated the calculation. We now form the monocarbonate and the calcite as in the experiment. And we now see that also gibbsite and microcrystalline aluminum hydroxide are oversaturated. And as in this example, the upper limit was set to 0, none is allowed to form. And if we would now click on the aqueous composition, we would see that we have now aluminum concentration and calcium concentration in our modeling, which are very similar to the experimental concentrations, and also the pH is very similar, and also the phase assemblage matches what we observed experimentally. And we can be happy. And this is one simple example for a metastability constraint, that a phase should be stable, should be formed, but due to slow kinetics does not form. It's like with you, you are unstable with regard to the atmosphere. Now we are here also in oxidizing conditions. If I would put your chemical composition into GEMS and let it equilibrate, you would ignite and burn to whatever, CO2, water, calcium carbonate, apatite. So you also would not be stable. So you are personally also a good example for such a metastability. Okay, we now go to the last part. Or is there any question so far? If I talk too much, please feel free to interrupt me. Everything's clear so far.
Yeah, everything's clear. No question. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I have a question.
Yes, please.
I want to know why should we remove these two phases, the Gibbs side and the the microcrystalline aluminate hydroxide.
Yes, it is.
Why should we remove it?
Yes, as we saw previously, is if we include them in the calculation, our phase assemblage is not fully correct, and especially the solution composition is not very correct.
And yeah, yeah.
Especially aluminum concentration and was strongly different from what we saw, much, much lower. And this is always indication that you might not have reached equilibrium. And then if you now would go to literature and check a bit, then you would find that in cements, where we might, if you form aluminum hydroxide, we might have it in amorphous or microcrystalline form. And then it would be an idea, the gibbsite, it only forms on the very long term. Maybe I should deactivate it and try to redo the calculation. I think very important with GEMS is, it's like with quantitative X-ray diffraction, with Rietveld analysis, you can refine everything. Here you can calculate everything, what you want. And also GEMS will calculate it nicely for you. But the result might be biased due to such metastability. And then you need to somehow take your expert knowledge and think a bit, was it really the correct setup, how I modeled? Does really a phase like gibbsite, could it really form in my system? And then you could think about, okay, maybe it's better to deactivate it. No? And this is also something where you need to gain your own experience. No? You need to check with experiments, you need to check with literature, and then you will find that, for example, gibbsite formation is would happen only probably at high temperatures or on the very long term. And, in our cementitious systems, we have a lot of these metastability constraints. And this you need to know. This is also why we make this course, that you get a bit experience.
I get it. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other question before I continue? We still have whatever, half an hour time roughly, but we can also continue. Also, if, as I mentioned before, if something pops up during during your exercises, just let me know. But just keep in mind a bit the time difference. Okay, we now come to part number 4. So now we want to make the combined calculation, the C2A plus calcium carbonate plus calcium sulfate. And we now want to do it. I now again switch back to GEMS. You should see the GEMS again.
Yes.
Okay, good. So actually, you can, what we can always do is to create a new record.
Or can we just...
Or we can clone it. We can use the previous one as a template for the new one. And in this case, we can clone it. You could alternatively use this for a new from scratch, and this would be the clone. Okay. Now I go to new clone. Now we name it. Keep it like this. Okay. Then I need to check quickly what to enter. Sorry. Okay. This, for example, we could delete. And then we add, I just need to check the correct number. So it's 5, we need the calcium sulfate. And this is 2.52, if I am correct. And we need again also the calcium oxide, which is 5. Okay, let me say okay. and then check, and then we calculate. And then we see a difference from the previous calculation. If we remember the first tutorial, we saw basically monosulfate and portlandite. And now we don't see monosulfate anymore, but we see ettringite. And the reason for this is that the calcite now prefers to make the monocarbonate, and then we have a lot of sulfate in the system, and then we can make the ettringite. So I go now back to the presentation. Okay. Okay, and so the result is, okay, I did not activate again the gibbsite, but it doesn't matter so much as it will not form. This is also important information. All this aluminum hydroxide is generally not stable if we have portlandite present. We only saw it previously in the system where we don't have where we did not add the calcium oxide. So here now the equilibrium is in a different way. We form ettringite, monocarboaluminate, calcite, and portlandite. And remember, we have sulfate to aluminum oxide, the molar ratio of 1, which should lead to formation of monosulfate. But as I said before, then as we have the calcite, the system prefers to make the monocarbonate. And then we have a lot of sulfate available to make ettringite. The monocarbonate, as you will see also later, is also a kind of a metastability issue, because this phase sometimes takes quite long to form, and then often hemicarbonate is formed instead. This is also another point where sometimes in cementitious systems, the modeling and the results may vary. Then we see we have the ettringite. We have here a solid solution between the sulfate and the carbonate. So there is some carbonate going also in the ettringite, which is generally occurring if we have such systems. And we see here again the detailed results. We have these 8 grams of ettringite. Then we have the carbonate, AFM, the monocarbonate, some surplus of calcite, and we have portlandite. And if we go here to this EQDC, we see all the concentrations, activities, activity coefficients of the individual ionic species. As we saw at the very beginning of this lecture, if we dissolve the portlandite, we not only have this calcium 2 plus and the hydroxide, but we also have a calcium OH plus, we have an ion pair, and so on, and so on. And all these different species are included in the calculations. You see that we have some ionic speciations, which are speciations which are positively charged, like the aluminum 3 plus. We have some other species, like the aluminum O2 minus, which are negatively charged. And the neutral ones, they have at the end this at sign. And in the neutral ones, we have the ion pairs, like the calcium carbonate in line number 7. But you also have here the dissolved gases, the dissolved methane in line 15, the hydrogen, the oxygen, and so on. So our solution is also much more complex than can be derived from the simple elemental composition you see here on the left side. Okay, so maybe quickly summary of the modeled results. Here we have our triangle with the tricalcium aluminate, calcium sulfate, and calcium carbonate. And if we are here on the axis between C3A and calcium sulfate, we form monosulfate, and then at later, if we have more calcium sulfate, we make the ettringite. And if we are beyond a molar ratio of 3, we have surplus calcium sulfate. And if we go here on this axis between C3A and calcium carbonate, you can, the pure C3A will form the C4AH13, the hydroxy AFM. And then you will form mixtures between the hydroxy AFM and hemicarbonate. And at higher additions of calcium carbonate, you form the monocarbonate. And if you go even higher, then you will have surplus calcium carbonate. And if you have a ternary systems, you can have, of course, different phase assemblages depending where you are. And actually, you could also use GEMS to calculate such triangles, to calculate such phase diagrams and to draw these lines. Of course, in simple systems, you could also use mass balance calculations, but GEMS is also very suitable to make such phase diagrams and to calculate those. So actually, basically, we did more or less these calculations at some points of the phase diagrams, and we found that we somehow succeeded, that our calculations fitted to the experimental results. With this, the presentation is finished. Are there any questions or problems we can treat now, which are of common interest? Then just let me know. Don't be shy. So if there are questions, just let me know.
Hi, Frank. What's the difference between the concentration in the last two slides?
Yes, wait. Which one do you mean?
What's the difference between this concentration and the IR concentration in the...
Ah, yes. Okay. This on the left side, this is what you would measure by ICP OES, if you would analyze it. Because ICP OES, solid analysis, will give you the total amount of calcium. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. If you take this as example. But the calcium is not only... is present in different forms in the solution, depending on all the solubility products and on all these on all the complex formation constants. So, for example, this would be calcium concentration, but the calcium is present as a calcium 2 plus. Mm-hmm. Then it's present as a kind of an ion pair or complex. This one, 9799. Then there's also a complex with hydrogen carbonate, and there's also the calcium OH plus.
So all those plus together we are equal to
all that. Those, yes. And if you put it in the ICP OES, it will just measure the sum of it.
Yes.
And GEMS, of course, has the capability to calculate all these individual spaces, or it needs to do it. It has all the equilibrium constants, all the activity products and all the complex constants built in the general database which comes with GEMS, the NAGRA TDB. And it's the same for the others. This is just what you measure by ICP.
Okay, thanks.
So any other question? Otherwise, we will take a quick glimpse to what we will do, or what you will do tomorrow morning on your own, and what we will do together on the afternoon. I will now quickly go to Okay, so, and if anything pops up, any question pops up during the day, just let me know. Now I go to GEMS China, and we will have the presentation. So we had the questions before. What should I do if I want to calculate various single files? Can I make it automatically? Yes, you can do. And these are the so-called process calculations. And we will do this tomorrow on a bit more complicated system because we will go for a hydrated Portland cement. So this will be already, this lecture will provide a lot of useful information for you, which you can already use in your practice of your PhD or postdoc project. Because we will tomorrow learn how we can calculate the hydration of Portland cement. And in generally this works, or we need to start like we did it before with the tricalcium aluminate. We first need to create a single system, and this single system will be the basis for a process file. And in this process file, we will vary systematically some parameters. And we will study it on the example of limestone, on the hydration of a Portland cement. And there will be also another task, how to study it in a blend with fly ash. And there you will also learn how to insert a composition of a fly ash into GEMS. You have seen, if you now go back to GEMS, you have seen up to now only this part. Here in the process, we have a very powerful tool to create all this process interpretation, this process batches. And if you, for example, want to add a fly ash, we need to access the database. And this works if I click here on this tool, and then I can access the database. And the nice thing is you cannot destroy anything, because it's also important information regarding GEMS. If you make a project, then you copy your database inside your project. And then you can make changes of the database, but they are related only to your project. So you cannot destroy anything if you make anything wrong. But in your project, you can modify also the database. And in the database, there is one bottom here, the compositions. And this is basically the XXA. This is the bulk composition we used as input. So if we now click on one of those, we see that we have here, for example, the tricalcium aluminate. And you see that it's composed out of two atoms or two moles of aluminum, three moles of calcium, and six atoms of oxygen. So there's only the very basic, chemical composition. There is no link to any thermodynamic data. Here in this database mode, you can then add whatever composition you want. And so strictly speaking, you could create a new one here. And for example, composition of the fly ash. And then you can insert it into your project. Yeah. And this we will practice tomorrow. So I think I will give you last possibility to ask a question. So anything unclear, did anybody have some technical problems which are not solved in the first, or in this first tutorial?
Hello?
No?
Hello?
Okay, good. So otherwise I would like to close this session and wish you a nice late afternoon or evening, and then we see tomorrow afternoon. And sorry, I did not, someone is speaking but not loud enough. Okay, I did not hear the person. I don't know. Okay, anyway, are we still all online?
Okay.
Yes, are we all online? Yes.
Yes.
So I would now stop the recording of the meeting. Mm-hmm. So I think we are 11, that's fine. So at the end, I would like to do a group photo. Huh? You know, I've been a couple of times in China, and I know that group photos are very important also for the university to show also international collaborations. So we will now do a nice group photo. I will make a screenshot.
Okay. So everybody open.
Ask that everybody makes the hair nice and turns on the camera. Okay, so everybody. It's very funny. Up to now, we all wear glasses. So that's interesting. So there are still three missing. Please put on your camera. Okay. There are still two missing.
完了。苗博士人呢？苗博士挂机了。武汉理工那个老师好像有。Otherwise,
we tomorrow. We still have a couple of days to try.
Maybe something wrong with their camera.
Okay. Okay, so we try tomorrow at the beginning. Huh? So, and then we have time to make you even nicer looking. Okay?
Okay.
So I say now goodbye. See you tomorrow. And if there's questions,
let me
know. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.